First of all, introductions, in case a lot of you know what, most of the names are new, so makes sense to do the intro. My name is Abhishek, and okay, intro, that's it. So we'll just jump right down to the Gyan for today, which is the CR and RC section of your CLAT. How to tackle those questions, what is the difference, what is going to be my strategy, what do I need to do over the next couple of months. I'll try and discuss all of these things step by step. The broad objective is to perhaps, I wouldn't say discuss every question of CLAT 2020. Obviously, that is not going to happen. So if you're here looking for an analysis, etc., then at best, it will be an overview of CLAT. But it won't be one question at a time. We'll discuss the whole thing, blah, blah. That is not going to happen. So let's just be clear on that, that I'm not going to discuss every question. The objective is just to tell you that, okay, look, this is what we should be doing when we see the actual paper. So broadly, that's my objective. So let's not get into the mindset that you can get all the 40 answers, 50 answers today. Okay. Now, what is our agenda? So broadly, first, let's talk about what is expected in this year's CLAT. Now, there are a couple of things that you will notice, starting with the fact that it's paper-based. A couple of years ago, it was online, and they just suddenly switched back to paper-based mode. So will that impact your preparation, this, that, and all? Absolutely not. On the contrary, especially for RC and CR, that makes your job a whole lot easier. I'll tell you why in a minute. But paper-based test, MCQ, as you're already aware, you've got negative marking as well. So that's a positive marking of 1 and a negative marking of 0.25. So I cannot just go randomly type AAAA whenever I'm not sure, or if I'm doing guesswork. It is not supposed to be done simply because there's a risk of negative marking. You've got 2 hours. You've got a total of 150 questions. So 120 minutes, 150 questions. So that means speed is at a premium. You have to ensure that you choose the right questions so that you get the most marks out of the allotted time. Now, this bit is something, the table on the right is something that you can find even on the official website of CLAT, which gives you the broad distribution of the number of questions across each of your subjects. So if you've got English language, you'll see that you've got 28 to 32 questions. The part that we want to focus on are two things: English language and the bottom to last point, which is logical reasoning. Again, 28 to 32 questions. Those are going to be my areas of focus today. The actual cutoff for CLAT, there is no actual cutoff. See, understand that CLAT is accepted by a lot of institutes, right? And of course, each of those institutes has a ranking, and hence they have their own cutoffs. So I can't tell you that, you know what, you should get this much. Because if your aspiration is top 5, and from 150, the 5th college cutoff is, let's say, 100, then you have to get 100. But if you're okay with the top 10, and for the 10th college, the cutoff is 80, then you need to get 80. So I cannot tell you what is the cutoff. I'm not going to bother with that. However, I'll give you a broad range of what you are supposed to target in the actual exams. The other variable being, I have not seen this year's paper. No one has. So I can't tell you right now that, okay, you know what, this much dot you get, you are through. That I can't do. What if this year's paper is easier? What if this year's paper is tougher? You make sure to look at the paper in front of you and decide that, okay, boss, last year, this was the information. I've seen last year's paper, and this year's paper looks broadly similar to that. So my numbers will broadly be the same. This year's paper looks a bit difficult, so my cutoff will reduce. This year's paper looks easier, so I need to get more questions correct. So let's not pinpoint and say, okay, this much is enough, this much is enough. But last year's data suggests that out of, if I assume 150, anywhere from 70 to 75% percent of the total marks of the exam should see you through to a competitive NLU. So that probably answers your question that, okay, boss, what is the sort of cutoff that you need to try for this year? Again, of course, that depends on the variable difficulty of this year's paper, and accordingly, you will figure out what to do. But let's assume a 75%, or just to be on the safe side, a little bit more than 80%, if you can get more than enough. All right. Now, that is point one. Point two is that there is no sectional cutoff. So let's assume 70%. Let's assume 70%. What is 70% of 150? Wait, I have to set permissions. Yeah, you guys tell me 70% of 150. So now you know that you need to get 105 marks. From that, from English, how many do you need? From GK, how many do you need? From LR, which is legal reasoning, how many do you need? From Quant, how many do you need? Irrelevant. They want a grand total of 105. That's it. Sir, but here's the deal. I am horrible at math, so I'm not going to attempt anything out of the math section. That's about, let's say, 20 questions, rounding it up. Okay. How many questions do you have left? 130. Can you tell me that you can get 110 from a 130? Sir, I could try, but exactly. So the problem is not that you are bad at math and should I skip math? Can I skip this? Can I skip that? I don't care. You do what you want, but get me a net score of 105 if I'm asking for it. All right. Get me a net score of 110 if that is what it takes. How is it relevant? Meaning from which sections is that total coming to 105 is irrelevant. So don't bother making it your life's mission to solve every question of legal reasoning. This is the other mistake that a lot of kids do. Legal reasoning, I am a future lawyer, I will solve LR fully. You solve 40 questions and you're like, huh? 1 hour already gone? Shh. What am I supposed to do? In 1 hour, I have to make up double of the score. And you're like, what to do? Exactly the problem. So you might have gotten all 40 questions correct. I'm not even denying that. You are fantastic at legal reasoning. Fair enough. But what is the point of spending all that time on LR? Sir, but future lawyer? No, they don't care. So get that into your mind before anything else, that it does not matter where that score is coming from and from where rather. I just need my score. That's it. If I say 110, you have to get 110. Now comes someone's question. Sir, how many should I attempt? Honestly, again, that I don't have an answer for. Because I don't know what is your historical accuracy rate. If your accuracy rate is only 70%, then you will probably end up attempting all 100. You will have to attempt all 150 to get 105. But if your accuracy is 80%, then you, excuse me, might have to attempt only 120 questions. If your accuracy is 100%, then attempt 110. Fine. I don't care. I want my score of 110. Yeah, I don't care how it's coming from, how many attempts you're making and all that. That you have to figure out. With me so far? With me so far, open, speak. There's a reason I've given you talking permissions.
Yes, sir.
Okay, I will assume yes. Now.
Yes, sir, we are with you.
Now that we need to get that number, we need to try and see from LR and English, how can I maximize a major chunk of my 105, 110, 115 marks, whatever it is. Okay, a couple of questions have come up here. Sanika, these questions I will take at the very end. Remind me, I'll take them, I have no problem. But that is more of a slightly general question, might not be restricted to LR and English. So I'll take those questions at the end, you know, general score improvement plan and all that. Give me some time to get to that. For now, let's focus our discussion on English language section and LR section. Once we are done with that, we'll take it totally. Okay. Now, how do I maximize my score? Sir, I know my broad target is that 105, 110, whatever. How do I get those marks from verbal? How do I get those marks from LR? Let's look at last year's verbal section, which we call English language. Now, if you look at English language, how many topics are there in English language? Only one. All 30 questions came from reading comprehension. What is reading and comprehension? Passages. So what does that tell you? Vocabulary, not required. Fill in the blanks, synonyms, antonyms of nasty words. Grammar, nothing. So that tells me that a quarter of the paper, to be precise, 1/5 of the paper, 20%, is only from passages, which presents us with a double-edged sword. Agreed, I don't need to study grammar. Agreed, I don't need to focus too much on vocab. But if 20% of the paper is RC, and my reading speed is poor, then start praying to all your gods, old and new. Pray to the fire god, pray to the knights god, whatever. But pray, there's nothing else you can do, right? So that tells us that, okay, boss, you have to do well in this. Look at LR, which is verbal reasoning. There is something called passage-based critical reasoning, and there is something called paragraph-based critical reasoning, and there is something called implicit statements. Now, when we go to this particular section, I will tell you what passage-based CR means. I'll tell you what paragraph-based means. More importantly, I'll first tell you what critical reasoning means. Okay, and then we'll take care of how to tackle these questions and all that. But what does it tell us? Paragraph, passage, RC, paragraph, passage, RC. It's extremely reading intensive. So no matter what you do, reading speed has to be on point. All right. So that's the first takeaway from today's session. Reading speed has to be improved on a daily basis. Sir, but what to read? Wait, that's coming up as well. If I look at the English section, what do I need to read exactly? Do I need to read novels? Do I need to read X, Y, Z? I'll tell you all of that at the end. But focus on reading no matter what. All right. Now, coming to this previous slide, again, where we said that, okay, boss, there's a lot of reading to be done. Please don't mistake reading for having to read every single word of every single passage to be able to crack RC questions, reading and comprehension. I didn't say that. I just said that everything is RC in verbal. So it's extremely intensive. But does that mean that you need to read every single word of every single passage to get the answers? No. That's what we will tackle. If you remember yesterday's lecture or day before, whenever, you had that whole concept of ABC. Do you remember that? Or was there a concept of ABC? Maybe for quant, I don't recall. Yes, no, what? Yes, what? Okay, so there was a concept of ABC. Can we do something similar for RC? Can we do something similar for CR? Let's check. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to teach you how to identify, even in passages, that certain questions are A's, RB's, and RC's. And if the entire paper is open to me, now that it is paper-based, I know how long is every passage, and I know how many questions are at the end of every passage, I can look at it and say, okay, boss, this is the passage I should attempt. Okay, boss, this is the question passage I should not attempt. Or you know what? I don't think I'll attempt every question of this passage. Why don't I just pick out the easy ones quickly and then knock them off? But how will I know that? Is by understanding what is this entire ABC approach and how do I classify questions. Now, there are 5-6 types of questions that typically turn up in an RC. The first is something called as the main idea or central idea of the passage, which is connected to also the title question, suggested to suitable title for this passage. So this is called the main idea question type, number one. Number two is what is called as the specific detail question type. In case you want to write it down, I'll go slower. Number one is main idea, which includes the question like what is central idea of the passage or theme of the passage or gist of the passage, etc. Plus the title question. So those two are in main idea. Number two is specific detail. What is specific detail? Basically, it is your keyword driven copy paste sort of question. What was the GDP of India in four years ago? Okay. So many trillion. Okay. So many trillion. Finish. Copy paste questions, that sort of what we call factual or data driven questions. Those are called specific detail questions. The third is something called an implied idea question. What is implied idea? Inference question, the what we call indirect ones. So inference questions are your third category. Then there is something called further application, meaning you might have to bring in some external knowledge to make sense of the question. You have to go beyond the passage a little bit, further application. And finally, the fifth question type called tone question. What is the style of the author, tone of the author and all. And my personal favorite, sixth, miscellaneous, any random stuff they'll put. Don't ask. Anyway, point being, what? Chakaru, what do I do with these question types? Simple. If I have a main idea question type in my passage, in one passage, let's say there are 5 questions, how many times will I be able to ask you a main idea question? How many times will I ask you main idea of the passage, primary purpose of the passage, primary purpose? Once. Because how can main idea and central idea be two different questions with the same answer? That is just stupid, right? I can ask you only once, right? Main idea. Out of 5, there'll be only one question, right? So understand that for that one question, if I'm running out of time, it probably does not make sense to read the whole passage if the rest of the questions are what we call your direct questions. Getting my thought process, everyone? Strength and weaken is what I said, further application means beyond, a little extra. So, let's get back to your passage. And I see that, okay, question number one is main idea. Okay. Now, what is a main idea? Hooray, boss. I will not be able to find the answer till I read the entire passage. Because if I miss one idea, then that will make me problematic. Right. But then the rest of them are direct. So why don't I just knock them off as quickly as possible and then time permitting, come back. If not, chuck it, big deal. But at least four questions should be gotten correct. Okay, boss, one thing I'm assuming in this, if you don't know how to copy paste a line directly from the passage into the options, then sorry, boss, even I can't help you. Let me be very clear. At least copy pasting should not be a problem at this stage. If you're telling me, sir, that is also a problem, then same thing, start praying, right? So let's just come back to this. Okay, Shruti, what we'll do is I'll take those questions later. For now, just let me get through this. Remember this and ask me at the end. I'll take care of that query. Okay. Now, where were we? Right. We were talking about passages. Now, let's go on to this passage. This is exactly the CLAT 2020 passage that came up. Now, climate change, I am not going to bother reading this. Now, look at this. To address the challenge of climate change, developing countries urgently require. Now, if you notice above, it says A type, meaning easy. How is this easy? Don't look at the keywords of the question. Look at the keywords of the options. National adaptation plans, short-term plans, technological solution, climate change tax, very good. So why don't I try it this way? That I try to knock off the question using this stuff. Where do I go? What was it? Wait. National adaptation plans, short-term technological and climate change tax. Can I notice if there is anything that says country to country adaptation plan? Anything? Not here. Anything short term? Anything, what is it? Technological solutions and climate change tax. Can't see anything. Can I go here and see what is what? Adaptation, I see in line 4. Right? Adaptation, adapting to climate change, adaptation, adaptation. These range, now look at this, these range from technological options to blah, blah, blah. So broadly, adaptation is required. It is not saying only technology you need to use. It ranges from A to B, meaning there's a lot of stuff inside it, but the broad umbrella is adaptation. Okay, adaptation, 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 adaptation. What else do you think the answer would be? This is my point. Okay, so adaptation, adaptation, adaptation. What else? This is why I call it an A type question. So don't really get into the whole mindset of what a so long passage, what do I do? My reading speed is so slow. Who cares? I want 105. I want 110. Sir, but who cares? Again, focus on the numbers, don't focus on the process. Don't take it to your heart that you left one question in the RC, but you solved 4 out of 5. Or I did not read the RC, I still got 4 correct. How is this possible? Magic? No, it's not magic. It's just basic keeping your eyes open. Don't take it to heart. Shah, I had to leave that one question. Shah, let's try. You'll waste 10 minutes on that one stupid question. That's the next thing that I'm trying to tell you. Don't waste time on stupid options and questions. If you know that, okay, boss, this is a main idea question, I will have to read the passage to come to the answer. There is no sense. Sorry, boss, I am out. Walk away. Now, look at this. Given below are the factors of vulnerability of poor people. This is still an A type. Although there are 4 things, and I've got 2, 3, 4, 2, 3, 4, 3, only 1, 2, 3. What does this tell me? Third point, I'm not going to bother verifying. Third point, lack of financial resources. I'm not going to bother because all options contain 3. Right. Now let's check this. Dependence on natural resources. Is it there for poor people, poor people, poor people, poor people? natural resources. Poor people dependent on natural resources. Bottom fourth line from the bottom. Right? So one is there, which means my answer is not option A, my answer is not option C. Getting it?
Yes, sir.
Which means, considering that my only two options are B and D, what do I need to do? Don't verify, just check four. If traditional knowledge is there, answer is option B. If traditional knowledge is not there, answer is option D. Let's check poor people, traditional knowledge, it's not there here. Poor communities, okay. Traditional knowledge. No, they are saying adapting. Traditional knowledge not given, no, leave it. Poor people, traditional knowledge not given. So what do I do?
So it is given.
Traditional knowledge, lack of it. What is it saying? Where is it?
No, lack is not given.
Lack is not given, right? Traditional knowledge can help. It is given. I know it's given, but lack of it is making them vulnerable. That's not given. So what do I do?
D.
What do you expect? Relax. Right? They are vulnerable, means what, they are likely to get affected because they don't follow traditional methods is what four means. No one is saying they don't. On the contrary, it's saying if you use more, it will help you improve. Does not mean that they lack it already. All right. So that's why your answer is D. Fair enough. It's a quick answer. This is exactly my point. I haven't bothered reading with all the content of the passage. I just look at something. I don't want to waste time. That's it. Getting it? Now look at the third one. Against the idea portrayed in the passage. Now, I have no idea what this answer is. But I look at my options. Again, I look at my options. Coordination between regional and national efforts is necessary. So I look for coordination. If it's given, then A is not your answer. Because it's asking which of these is against. Coordination, adaptation, and national circumstances, social dimensions we've just read in para 1. Yes? Right, so C cannot be my answer. And we just now realized that traditional knowledge, if you use, it will reduce your problems. So D is also given in the paragraph. So C and D are not your answer for sure. Right? Now I need to check if coordination is given. If not, I'll mark A blindly. Right? So let's look at coordination between national and regional. Wait, is this here? Coordination. Coping strategy, coordination. National within local communities, so coordination sort of given. Wait, let's just be clear with this. Local coping strategies and knowledge need to be used in synergy with government and local interventions. So local plus regional given. Oh, local plus regional given. So what's my answer? Clearly B.
B.
Broadly, what I'm trying to tell you is, don't take it to heart that you have to read the passage and every single line and every single word. Why? Who cares? I'm just trying to get you to the end objective. You want your score. Who cares where it's coming from? Legally, of course, without copying and all that. But who cares if you've read it or not? As long as you and I both get the same answer in the shortest amount of time, why not? Right? Traditional knowledge should be used through what? This should be direct. Even if you don't read the passage, you should know broadly what at least cannot be the answer. You know what cannot be the answer? Stupid options like C, right? And we just read what the answer should be, if you remember. What should be the answer? Speak. I have given talking permissions for a reason. Don't make it boring and a monologous one. I don't want to be the guy who keeps talking and boring. Clearly, no other option left. Right? So what? In a matter of 5 minutes, we have done 4 questions. Not bad at all. Also, 5 minutes for 4 questions with me explaining one option, and all that. Okay. So this is why it's taking so long. If it were you in the heat of the moment in the exam, you could have done it faster. Now, what is this?
So can you explain once?
Which one?
The previous question, fourth one.
Traditional knowledge, where was it given? Only in the last and second to last paragraph, right? So it's not here. It's not here. It's probably here. Look at it. Communities must build their resilience, including adopting technologies, while making the most of traditional knowledge and local coping strategies and knowledge, local meaning traditional, need to be used with the government ones. Right? So they're saying you local people use your own traditional knowledge, and then this local strategy needs to be in tune with the regional one. So in short, traditional knowledge needs to be in tune with the regional one, which gives us whatever option that was. B, I guess. Yeah, B. Better?
Yes, sir.
Okay, now look at the next question. Now, I know I have marked it as a B only because for the first 4 questions, I haven't read the passage deep enough for me to quickly know where the word resilience occurred in the passage, and hence accordingly, what is the answer to this question. I'll repeat. I am not saying that you find this to be difficult. I am saying that considering the first 4 questions I haven't read through and through in the passage, I don't know where resilience is. If I have the time, I can go for it. But if you have read too fast that in one reading you can't see the word resilience, then probably leave it and forget it. No problem. One question let go of because you don't have time, I'm okay with it. So where is resilience? You want me to solve it? Look at this. Communities must build their resilience, including adopting appropriate technology while making the most of traditional knowledge. So what does that mean? I have to use technology and mix it with traditional knowledge. And that is what, as per the passage, resilience means. So what is the meaning of resilience as per the occurrence and usage in the passage?
Flexibility.
The standard meaning of resilience is toughness, which we know, which almost all of you know. But the question was not what is the meaning of resilience as a standalone vocab question. The question was what is the meaning of resilience as used in the passage, which is why communities must build their resilience by doing what? Mixing these two, traditional plus modern. Means what? They don't say they include toughness by doing these two. It means they show flexibility to use technology as well as traditional methods, which is why your answer is C and not and A, right? This is one of those questions that could have lost you a 0.25, which is okay. Assuming the first four you got correct, this is something that between A and C, if you marked A, I will let go of it and not, you know, beat you over the head with it that, oh, what did you do? Happens. Now, coming to the ABC that you talked about for QA, LR and all that in the last lecture. As I just discussed, the sort of question that we just did, the resilience one, I classified it as a B purely because I haven't read the passage deep enough to know where I saw resilience. And of course, since you knew that there was a googly, that was a question I should have let go of at that moment. But the four that we solved before were all A's. And the objective is to tell you why I called them A's. Are we clear with my understanding of the situation? Right? So don't get too bogged down with the topic. Don't get too bogged down with the length of the passage. Don't get too bogged down with so many new words are there in the question and the options. Oh, what do I do? All we did was copy, paste, copy, paste, copy, paste. That's it. We didn't use our extra brains for even a minute extra than required. Because I know that it is futile to waste my head on things like this. And ooh, let's learn something new about how we are planning to tackle climate change. Wow, that's not my objective. My objective is answer as many questions as I can correctly in the shortest amount of time possible. A mistake that a lot of people commit in RC, apart from taking things to heart, ki, okay, boss, I've solved five, from them I've solved four, means I have to solve the fifth one. That's one mistake. The second mistake is you try to read an RC like you would a novel or an article. Big mistake. What? Why is that a mistake? Why do you read a novel or why do you read an article? A, either to get knowledge, or B, to get entertained, or both, right? Why else would you read novels or articles? Correct? Right?
Yes.
Right, so there are only two objectives behind reading a novel or article, A, to get entertained, or B, to get knowledge. Neither of which is the objective behind an RC reading, which a lot of people forget. That I'm not reading an RC to gain any knowledge of, wow, it's so interesting. Nothing of that sort. I need to understand broadly 1, 2, 3, 4 things are talked about. From this, he goes to this, then states advantage, this, this, then disadvantage, this, this, then summary, then opinion, closure, whatever it is. I need to just understand what are the various things and how are they flowing from one to the other. That's it. So, oh, this is talking about some biology experiment and psychology and art and all that. What do I do? Don't crib and cry. Your expression should not change based on the topic presented in front of you. That's the gist of it. Okay. So yes, ABC relies more in RC on the question type. If I've got question types that are indirect a whole lot, then I'll probably skip that RC. Still try and squeeze in maybe one direct question if I can. If not, leave it. Don't take it too hard. All right. So if you want, you can take a screenshot of this. A couple of people have already asked me, sir, recording milega kya? I don't know. I honestly don't. Those who have registered and you've joined the seminar, the lecture, there is a high chance you will get it if you hit that register link and all that. But I really can't promise that. You'll have to reach out to your local mentors and they'll get the URL and probably share it with you. But again, I can't really commit and say that you will get. I don't know. Okay. So let's go on to the next set of things. How to identify? Okay, so Raghavi has asked us how to identify what type of passage it is, like authoritative, etc. Why do you need to? Unless a question is asked, what is the tone of the RC? What is the style of the RC? Do I really need to get into that? Considering you're anyway short on time, and as you've seen, you got four questions without reading too much. Do I really need to? Yes, no, can't say. So, to answer your question, if there is a specific question, what is the style of the passage? Argumentative, descriptive, factual, analytical. Only then you figure it out. What is the tone of the passage? Cynical, neutral, and sarcastic, and sardonic. Only then you identify the tone. If it's not required, don't waste time on it. Especially considering without reading and deep diving and deeper analysis, if we can get four questions correct in 4 minutes, why do you want to waste time on that one question? Don't get into that mindset. Getting it? There's a high chance that you are getting into all of this only because you have run out of questions to solve. My point is, you will not run out of questions to solve. Once you know that you need to get only so and so to get into a good law school, why bother with the others? Okay? Right? Which is exactly what is there on this slide. Knock off everything that you can. Mentally put a circle or something on something like a question 5 that you might want to come back to later, because that's only one question, right? So you just have to scan the word and probably knock off the answer. So probably mark a gola on 5, then solve 6, 7, 8. Okay, I can't solve 6, 7, 8. Probably 9 I can solve, 10 I leave. Da-da-da-da-da-da. Knock off all those A's, everything across the paper, then come back. Who's stopping you? Right? So this is the idea, right? I'm assuming you guys have taken a screenshot, so I'll go to the next one. The next passage, snow was falling. I'm not going to bother. Remember, the objective is not to read. I'm not going to bother. Terrace, whatever. That's it. That is my expression. I don't care. Now look at this. Which of the following suggests a synonymous meaning to the words providence and crescendo? The fact that they are in quotations means they have asked us the synonyms the way they have been used in the passage. But generally, do I know the meaning of providence? Question, do I know the meaning of providence? No, chuck it. Do you know the meaning of crescendo, perhaps?
No.
No. What do I do with this question?
Another line.
Not now. Right? But even if you're focused on vocab a little bit, honestly, because you guys are trying for other exams apart from CLAT, ILET perhaps, SET meaning SLAT, or you're targeting your state CETs perhaps, or you're targeting some Christ University Bangalore. These exams you are targeting perhaps apart from just the CLAT, right? Which means that on some level, those exams, because they have vocab, you will be doing a little bit of it, right? Strangely enough, I have marked this question type as A because I needed to know only the meaning of crescendo. Mark the answer with just one option. Crescendo means the summit or peak. So the beat of the DJ reached the crescendo and then he dropped the beat and ding, 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 ding. That's how they play their songs. Horrible, but whatever. So then, ding, ding, ding. So that's how the beat drops, right? So what do you mean by reaching a crescendo? Highest point. Now that I know highest point, the second word is what, second word crescendo has to mean highest point. Apex, nadir, prudence, upsurge. Which of these cannot be an answer? Prudence. Right? Apex is the only thing that makes sense, because upsurge is a continuous growth or a continuous rise, whereas crescendo is the actual top, the summit, the peak of it. Which is why, just by knowing that apex means peak or highest point, you have your answer as A. Obviously, this is assuming a little bit of vocab you are aware of. But if you choose to not solve this question, I am fine with it. This is one of those things that, yeah, if you get it, you get it. If not, chuck it. Right? Just like resilience, we just happened to find it. Only because we had solved four, we figured, let's take a shot. But this is the first question of that passage. Probably not the right thing to do. But now that I know crescendo, I marked apex because that was the only option left. Getting it? Next, Shruti has nicely asked us, so something that I want to answer indirectly. Shruti, the answer to your question is, who cares? Getting it? As long as you know crescendo means X and apex means X, mark synonym apex, chuck the rest. Right? This is not a vocab exercise for us to know what is the meaning of nemesis, zenith, laxity, prudence, short-sightedness, upsurge. What is your objective? Find the, not even find the answer, find the correct option in the shortest time possible. Who cares if you don't know every word of every option? Does it matter? No. So I know the meaning of nadir, but I'm choosing tonight to not tell you, because this is not a vocab building class. This is a class to how to get the option and walk quickly. All right. Don't take it too hard. You get the objective, right? As long as you're clear on that, we'll push forward to the next one. Right. I wish I could tell you, but I don't want to, because then that sort of defeats the purpose, right? We're just wasting time on the rest of it. Now look at this. The passage has been adorned with numerous figure of speeches. Which of the following combinations is correct? Not going to do this, because that would mean that I have to read the passage. Hence, C type. Getting it? Next, the passage demonstrates which one of the following motifs of cat's life. What the heck is a motif? Heck no. I'm not going to do this. The author's description of he was under no constraint of human implies means what? Indirectly. Get lost. I'm not going to do this. The lines, but he never faltered and never once cried. He had not suggest that. What the heck just happened? Six, somehow through Jugaad, I was able to solve. I skipped 7, I skipped 8, I skipped 9th, I skipped 10th. Does that mean I'm in trouble? Absolutely not. Why? Because this is one of those nasty passages that will trap you if you sit and solve it. Or if you say, okay, you know what, let's just take a shot. This is the next point. The reason I took this passage specifically is to tell you what sorts of questions to avoid. Suggest that, implied that, too many figures of speech they are asking. Heck, lots of people don't even know what are figures of speech. Onomatopoeia and tika, tuka, tika and all those things. So let's not bother. I have to read the passage, right, to find out which of these exist, which of these don't. If there's a figure of speech that I don't know what it is, how can I say if it's there or it's not there? Then you're in trouble. So why bother with 7? Implied, not going to happen. Motif, heck, I don't know what is motif, left. Suggest, left. So does that mean I'm in trouble? No, wait. This is just the second passage. There will be enough passages later on. That's the next thing. Just because you left more or less an entire RC altogether, does that mean that you are not going to get anything else correct? Who said so? But are we clear why did we leave this passage or most of it?
Because they are time consuming.
Because they're time consuming and too much deep thought is required. You have to go in implied idea, inference, draw there. Not happening. Motif, you still don't know what is motif, right? So is there any sense? If you don't know figures of speech, is there any sense? So for two questions, one implied and one suggest, I'm not going to bother reading this entire paper. Right? Understand the thought process. Don't take it to heart. That is the major thing. I had to leave an RC. Don't cry. There is more. Wait. Okay. So this is passage 2 done. Let's see more stuff. I'm not going to bother with this. My expression is I'm not going to read. Why? Because I know that I don't have the time for it. My job is to knock off as many easy ones as I can and walk away. All right. Why do you think the author called the trial strangest murder trial he ever attended? Yeah, I won't know this till I read that entire passage. Right? Sorry, I think I went on pause. So, why do you think has the author called the trial strangest murder trial he ever attended? Now, this I can't do. So, I'll probably leave it for later. Probably. All right. I'm not saying I will skip this altogether. I'm just saying probably not the wise option to do right now. Now, look at this question. Question 12. His eyes suffused. Forget the line. Read the next part. Can be called as, and look at the option, personification, simile, onomatopoeia, none of the above. If you know fairly what are your figures or speeches, can you quickly tell me what is the answer to this?
B. Simile.
Why? Why?
Or like is used.
Like. Stop. Finished. Like. What else do you need? I didn't read a single word of the passage. One answer in the bag. Only because you know personification means XYZ, can't see it here. Simile, like I saw. Onomatopoeia means sound, not seen here. Gone. Pray such more questions exist. 13. The expression pecking his eyes could refer to which of the following? I haven't read the passage. Probably I'll come to this later. Why was Mrs. Salmon convinced that the man she saw had committed the crime? Can I try this? Mrs. Parker's house, wearing gloves. These are nice keywords. Hammer in his hand, laurel bushes. Another keyword. Suffused with horrifying and brutal fear. And clearly in the light of the, what is that? Street lamp. So this is something that I can probably figure out. Mrs. Salmon. Where is Mrs. Salmon? Mrs. Salmon was called in the court. Okay. She looked at the big man. Now, why did she say that he is the killer? There was moonlight. See here. There was moonlight. And when the man looked up, he had the lamplight on his face. Is there a hammer, laurel bushes, anything given? Not given, right? Right. So what is my answer to this? Lamplight.
D.
Two answers in the bag. Just by scanning. Because this is a fairly short passage, right? So if you can come back to it considering it's just a conversation, probably 11th strangest murder trial you can attempt. If you saw pecking his eyes somewhere, you could attempt. But I would suggest not do them right now. Okay. Who was murdered in the scene? Probably not something I can do quickly. So three questions in the bag, walk away. Under 4 minutes. Now I feel a bit more calm. Or rather, I'm trying to make you guys feel a bit more calm. That, okay, you know what, boss, this is still possible. All right. So this is RC. There is more stuff to be covered in RC, this next passage and all. But honestly, I don't want to, because there is one more section to cover after this. So all I want to ask you is, are we clear broadly with how I tackle a passage and how you should rather?
Yes, sir.
Everyone, yes, sir. Right? So, yes, to identify the question types will take a little bit of practice, but broadly understand, I am not really concerned with each and every single keyword. I saw laurel bush, I saw hammer, I saw lamplight, I saw this. That's it. And can I crack it? That's all I wanted to try. All right. Again, we're still not suggesting that this will ensure that you get the answer to every question, because there might be one of that nasty question like resilience in the first passage. But that's the point, right? If you knocked off four quickly, then probably don't take that one question to heart and say, okay, you know what, leave it. Because what is the point in the end? Get me the 105, where I don't care, right? So let's just focus on that end goal rather than focusing on every minute thing, every answer I need from every passage. I need to read every single line. Why? Chillax. Okay, so let's go on to logical reasoning. And what we noticed was something called paragraph-based CR. That's about 12-ish questions. And passage-based CR, which is 20-odd questions and implicit statements. What is all this? CR stands for critical reasoning. Okay, apparently you have a law scoop class. If you wish to carry on and watch that lecture instead, you can go ahead. I have no problem. Those who want to stick around, stick around. Okay, now CR stands for critical reasoning. Critical reasoning broadly has these question types that you may have seen called assume, the author assumes which of the following, or which of the following can be used to strengthen the argument, weaken the argument, parallel reasoning, flaw in the reasoning, main idea again. These sorts of words, if you have seen in your mocks or anywhere, these are your critical reasoning questions, right? Now, because there are lots of question types in this, critical reasoning tends to get a little bit complicated. Also, because a lot of critical reasoning question types are based on add-on information. I'll give you an example, assumption. Simple. Today, I am teaching you CLAT test taking strategy. Let's just say that this is my passage. Today, I am teaching you CLAT test taking strategy. What is my assumption?
That we won't learn the strategy.
Repeat that.
That the students are willing to learn the CLAT strategy.
A, you are willing to learn. Okay, what else? That you need it, you're facing some difficulties, that my strategy will work, that's my assumption, or that you are all taking CLAT, of course. Fair enough. Did I tell you any of this when I made that comment, today I am teaching you this? Did I tell you any of this? No. Right? This you got from the 4 or 5 options that were there. So it's not given to us in the passage. This is something that you have to figure out with some extra bit of akkal. That is what makes critical reasoning a wee bit difficult. is because a lot of it is based on extra stuff that necessarily need not be mentioned in the passage. So that is where critical reasoning tends to get a bit weird. And that's why I would say that understand the basics. To be honest, if you look at a flowchart of how to solve a strengthening question, weakening question, parallel reasoning question, assumption question, it is hopelessly simple. And you know what? I think we are just giving gyan at this point. So let's just look at, one second. Look at this. Which of the following strengthens the author's argument? Now, what do you mean by this question? I have to give you one more point in your favor, or rather I have to give one more point in the author's favor. What is the author's point is what I have to find out. So if I go to this, a passage that has been given to me, it's spread across two slides. Now that tells me that I have to be a bit fast at reading to be able to understand what is the point that the author is trying to make, right? So till I read this, I cannot go ahead with this. Bringing us to the first question type, which of the following conveys the main idea in the passage? Oh God, I can't do this till I read the passage end to end. So this is probably something that I would leave for later, or I would try to scan it quickly and go for it. Number one. The second thing here, it is question two, relax, typing mistake. Look at this, assumes. Assumes means what? External information, probably not something I want to do right now. Look at the third one, strengthens. Now, if I have done the main idea question, I can solve this as well. But if I haven't, then I won't be able to do both. Now look at this, what does the author indicate? Again, slightly difficult. Look at this one. The author has targeted and severely criticized which of the... Now this I can do. Why? Too few keywords. Digital journalism, criticized, targeted, which factor, social outreach, credibility of information, lack of information. Now digital journalism, social outreach, credibility and lack of information. Where is the passage? Digital journalism. Where is digital journalism? Digital journalism. What are the factors that we are criticizing? The author is criticizing. Credible information given. Right? Second page. Second paragraph. Right? So why not I knock off my question straight away? I got one. If I had read the passage, I could have gotten at max two more. Getting it? Yeah, it was there on the first slide, but there was no criticism mentioned in the first slide. The criticism was in the next part, credibility of information. But anyway, yeah. My point is,
Extend this question again.
Social outreach was given. Yes, I agree. But it wasn't criticized. It is talking about... See, wait. If I look at my first slide, it is talking about social outreach where? Where? Not here. Look at this one. Where is social outreach anyway? Right. There needs to be a conducive atmosphere for credible information. So that's the only one given to me, right? Directly. So that is why I need to mark that one as the option that is obvious to me. Getting it? See, I'm not saying that's the answer necessarily only because of my line that I saw. You may have read the passage and found out the same thing. That's fair. But I don't really want to waste time, because if I do, then I might as well read the entire passage and solve the other two. I think question one and question three as well, I could have solved. But broadly, try to understand that I'm trying to squeeze in one answer like five without reading it. And if I do have the time for it, read it. And at best, you can do one and three fast. So this is still a heavily B's and C's driven passage. That is my point. Getting it? Yes, no, can't say what.
Yes, sir.
Okay. That is a passage-based critical reasoning question set where assumptions, strength and weaken, four, five questions are there at the end of that passage. This is what we call a paragraph-based CR, where there is one paragraph, short para, and only one question at the end of it, which is given at the end. The conclusion drawn in the first sentence depends on which of the following assumptions. Now I'll tell you how to solve this. What is the conclusion? First sentence. If highways were restricted to cars and only those trucks with capacity of less than 8 tons, most of the truck traffic would be forced to run outside highways. So it's saying that if you keep only these two type of people, cars and less than 8 ton trucks, then they will be forced to run outside highways. Why is he saying it? Such a reduction in the amount of truck traffic would reduce the risk of collisions on highways. Now, what does it tell me? That why are they doing this? They want to reduce highway collision, which means that if you are saying these two types of people are, if only they are allowed, then the others will not use the highway, right? Which means what is the assumption? I'll repeat. They are saying what? I want to keep highways open to only these two types of people so that the others don't use the highways. And if only these two types of people are on highways, collisions will reduce. So why am I saying keep these two people and throw these out? Must be something about the others causing collisions on highways. Who are these others? Non-cars and trucks greater than 8 tons. Right? Where is it? No? Okay, say for example, I'll give you a stupid example. I'm saying that if I kick Shruti out of the webinar, then the class will be a lot more quiet and organized and disciplined. Right? If I kick Shruti out of the webinar, then the class will be a lot more quiet and disciplined. What is my assumption? That there is some connection between Shruti being here and the class being less disciplined due to her. This much logic clear?
Yes, sir.
So my assumption is that keeping Shruti would result in indiscipline, something like that.
Yes, sir.
Same logic here. If I get rid of X sorts of vehicles, then there will be fewer collisions on highways. Which means what? Those X sort of people, drivers or vehicles, cause collisions on highways. Right? So who are the ones that are told to not use highways?
Trucks.
Trucks more than 8 tons.
Trucks more than 8 tons.
More than 8 tons. So that means the assumption has to be that the other trucks are greater than 8 tons, and because they are on highways, there is some problem. Honestly, there's only one option that says the greater than 10, 8-ton trucks cause some problems. Which option is it?
C.
C? Right? Now, randomly, I heard someone say C. Okay, randomly, I heard someone say C. And I say, very good, Tarushi. I'll give you a chocolate because you said C. What is my assumption then? I heard someone say C.
That.
And I said, Tarushi gets a chocolate because she said it. So what is my assumption? That someone is Tarushi. Correct? That is an assumption. You will be given X and you are saying hence Y. You're like, what the heck is going on? So there must be some connection between X and Y that hasn't been mentioned. If it hasn't been mentioned, is why it is an assumption, right? That's the logic. Missing link dhoondna hai. Oh, sorry. You have to find the missing link between these two. Getting it?
Yes, sir.
Now, this as an assumption question is a B type. But the passage assumption is a C type. Why? Because longer. So more unknown connections are possible, which is why the passage CR, I have mentioned it as passage assumption CR, I have mentioned as a C type. All right. Now look at this question. Main idea. This I can do. I read, I understand, and I can knock off this main idea question. If I can do that for a passage in RC and all, then surely for a paragraph based CR, I can do. I don't want to do this. Relax. I don't want to do this. Raghvi, which question? The highway question?
Yes, sir.
Hey, Shruti, don't take it too hard. These are just examples. Relax. Raghvi, which question? Why is the option not D?
So the highway question.
Highway question? Okay. So in the highway question, what am I saying? What is the missing link? If I keep these sorts of people and only these sorts of people in the highways, or rather on highways, then the others would have to use non-highway roads, which means what will reduce as per the question? Collisions on highways, right? Right?
Yes, sir.
What is it saying? That if I keep these two players and ask the others to get out, then this will be a safe idea. Which means what? I have to assume that these two people don't cause accidents or are less prone to accidents. And those sorts of people, by staying here, are more factors that cause accidents, which is why I'm getting them out of here, right? Which is exactly the opposite of what D is saying. Getting it?
Yes, sir.
Getting it?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So D is going in the exact opposite direction as what you wanted to assume. Why can't it be A, Shreyas? Okay. I am saying it should be done. Okay. Why? Because, see, understand, convenience is not the focus of the passage, right? What is the focus of the passage? I keep these two people so that on this road, so that accidents will reduce, which means by excluding those people and keeping these two people, accidents will reduce. So is the fact that I'm making it convenient for them the point? What is my argument relying on? Safety rather than convenience, which is exactly why I will a sort of okay, even if it's not convenient, who gives a damn, right? Something like that. Even if it's not convenient, should I not tell? No, truck drivers, poor guys. And where is the 8-ton wala part? That's the other issue. Where is the 8-ton part? So I have to bridge the gap between things that are given and that are disconnected, not just generally all trucks. Okay, so that is 6. Someone had a question, are the passages in CR smaller than English RCs? I'll answer that when we come to strategy. Right, now look at this. Again, a silly looking easy question. This is what is called your implicit assumption question. This is definitely an A type. Just tell me A, B, C, D, what's your answer? Stupid question. How do you solve this? Reverse. Read 1. Hence, read the statement. Does it form a link? If yes, fine, keep it. For example, Chennai and Delhi are connected by air service. Do I need to assume that to say, go by aeroplane to reach Delhi from Chennai quickly? Of course I need to. So one has to be part of your answer. Getting it? Thought process clear?
Yes.
No? Okay. Chennai and Delhi are connected by air service. Do I need to put that as a precondition for me to say go by aeroplane to reach Delhi from Chennai quickly? I have to, right? If they're not connected, then how can I say go by aeroplane? Getting it? Shruti? Okay. So I need to assume 1, which means your answer is not B. Okay. Now look at B. There is no other means to commute from Chennai to Delhi. Do I need to assume this to say go by aeroplane? Go by aeroplane specifically? No. There might be other methods, means to reach Chennai from Delhi. So 2 is not part of the answer, which means B is not my answer. Option B. Check 3. The air distance between Delhi and Chennai is less. Do I need to assume that to say go by air to reach quickly? Of course I need to. Right. I have to assume that the distance is smaller. Only then will I say use this method instead, which means your answer is C. Pretty easy, I guess. Look for these sorts of questions. Because it's a pen and paper test, you can flip around and check, right? Where are these chindi small questions? Ah, tick, 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 tick. 1-1, 2-2 minute answer. Pray you get more of these. Getting it? I think you did. So I'm going to assume you did, and I'll go on to the next part, which is CLAT test taking strategy. Now, it's a very straightforward thing. You've got, let's say, around about 30 questions in your RC. Let's say that you've got 30 questions in RC. Means that from the analysis that you have, we will put it up later on, there's a likelihood of you getting about 16, 18 questions from the RC section from the A type. Okay. Which I want you to knock off in 15 minutes. Now you're probably thinking, oh, 15 minutes, how? Don't get scared. I took more than 15 minutes because I have to explain every option, this, that. Did you understand? Yes, no, doubts, blah, blah, blah. To be very honest, this will take you a lot less than that. Okay. So 15, 18 easy questions, and from them you need an a sort of 80% accuracy is what I would figure. I would say 16, 18 is still on the lower side. From 30, you can easily attempt a total of 20 odd questions. With 20 attempts and an accuracy of about 80%, that's 16 correct. Your total net score will be 16 into 1, 16 minus 0.25 into 4 that you will lose for the 4 incorrect. So net score will be 15, which you can get easily from the first 15 odd minutes, 18 odd minutes. Okay. Then if I tackle probably a couple of more B types, that's another 2-3 minutes. Right, another 2-3 minutes. So that's a grand total of probably 18 odd marks totally in about 22 odd minutes. This is only RC, English language. Then if I go to CR, because of the complexity of the questions, probably it would take me another good 10-12 minutes, maybe as high as 15 minutes, to at best be able to knock off 12 questions. That's the maximum I feel we can go ahead with. So from the 12, if I get 10 correct, then that's another 10 marks, 9 marks, so that's 9.5, and the initial 18, so that's a grand total of 27.5 within 20 plus 15, 35 minutes. So in 35 minutes, imagine 35 minutes, that's a grand total of 27 marks, which is gold at this stage. Now, assuming that the cutoff last year for the top NLUs was 105, assuming 105 from that, if you remove 27, what are you left with? 88, right? 88 marks you need to get from the rest of it. Okay. What 15 marks? 15 marks you will get from RC in about 20 odd minutes, and you will get another 9-10 marks from the, not 9-10 marks, sorry, you'll get 17 odd marks from RC, and you'll get another 10 odd marks from your CR section in about 35 minutes. That's a net score of about 27 in 35 minutes. So assuming the total is 105, your final target, remove 27 from that. What do you need? Not 105. So that 78 marks, sorry, not 87, 78 marks you need. Total time is 150 minutes. What am I saying? 120 minutes total time. Wait, let me type. 120 minutes total time. From those, how much have we utilized? 35. What are we left with? What are we left with? How much time? 85 minutes? Perfect. Keep that number in mind. What's your target score? 105 marks. From that, how many have we gotten already? 27 to 28 marks. So 105 minus 27, 28 is 78, 77 marks. So what is your next goal? 77 marks, let's say worst case scenario, 80 marks, worst case scenario. And how much time do I have left? 85 minutes. Suddenly, if you have not wasted your time reading any of the passages and knocked off all these direct ones and probably one or two sneaky little indirect ones, that apex question and all that, that gives you a truckload of time to tackle your time-consuming section like LR. See, the problem with LR meaning legal reasoning, the section is easy, it is just lengthy because there is too much information that you need to process. And it's not like you can skip through and say, oh, okay, two keywords matching, A is the answer. It's not how it goes. You need to take your time with that question. You need to buy dinner, get flowers, get her coffee. There's a lot of gifts involved in Ella. So there's a lot of effort that needs to be taken. The end result is that you'll get a score, but you'll be left wondering, oh, I wasted so much time. That's exactly why I want your options. That's exactly why I want you to maximize what you can from RC and CR. CR, even in case of CR, try to knock off the paragraph-based CR, the short ones quickly. Then go to the passage-based CR. The benefit again is that because it's pen and paper, you have the entire thing open to you. You can just quickly scan and flip pages and figure out what to do. All right. So make sure that you are not wasting time on stuff that you know that is difficult. And you are also sneaking in one or two questions here and there to make that total go from 27 to, let's say, a 30. Okay. So if I broadly say that we got about, what did we say? 18-ish marks from RC out of 21, 22 attempts. And we got what? About 10-ish, 12-ish marks out of CR. Again, this is all from the paragraph ones mostly, and that chutta implicit assumption one. One passage-based CR, if you're able to knock off, that will again boost your score up to, let's say, 12 or 15 maybe. So that 18 plus 12 will now become 18 plus 15. That's even better. So that's broadly what I would suggest your target score should be. But mota mota, the point is 35 minutes. 35 minutes. This is going to be your task. Noticing which questions are easy, quickly knockable, and not questioning yourself at every direct question state. Could this be? Is it indeed so easy? It is easy. That's why it's a direct question. Okay. So don't keep questioning yourself. Oh, I don't know. How did I get the answer so quickly? Anyway. So that is where your confidence is going to help out and not make you second guess everything and waste time. So keep this in mind broadly. 35 minutes for about 25 to 28 marks. That's your broad range. Maybe 40 minutes for 33 marks. That's also fine. A couple of minutes here and there will not make a difference. But don't go beyond that. All right. Now, the passages in CR, RC, whatever, are very clearly mentioned in the CLAT directives as any historically significant fiction, meaning some sort of famous book or collection of short stories or whatever, or from non-fiction, meaning they are from the editorials mostly. So make it a habit, especially for passage-based CR, to read editorials of newspapers like the Hindu Times of India, etc. Because if you notice the source of the passages that we wrote, and if you notice CLAT official paper that you can download and check, it was from the Hindu, the Indian Express, the Times of India. All the passage-based CR questions were from these newspapers and their editorials. So if the language is fairly manageable, if the vocabulary is fairly manageable, then your reading speed should sort of take care of itself. And you will be able to knock off one or two more questions in passage-based CR that I left because we didn't read the passage. Remember that, I think question 1 and 3 or something I left because they were a bit time consuming. You can knock them off if you are fast enough, right? Broadly, the rest of it is the same that you've seen, that you need to practice a lot of tests from some sort of portal or some sort of question sheet. Practice the past paper of CLAT to see, apart from these passages, which ones were more direct, more indirect, passage-based CR, strengthen, how to solve, weaken, how to solve, analyze them, find out what are the tips and tricks for strengthen, weaken, etc. Find out also from your mock clats, where is it that you're going wrong. Understand what sorts of mistakes you're making, where you're losing time, where you're spending time, where the output is great in these sorts of questions, where the output is not great, meaning you get the answer correct, but it took time. So that's where you need to figure out all this from a sort of holistic or overall perspective. So that you know that, okay, boss, I will prioritize also my sections. Should I solve LR first, meaning legal reasoning? Should I solve math first? Should I solve RC, which is English first? Should I solve logical reasoning, meaning your critical reasoning and all first? Then if that first is done, what is the second one? Prioritization, allocating time to each section and religiously sticking to it, that boss, in English, I will give only these many minutes. In critical reasoning, I'll give only these many minutes. All of that planning, you need to do step by step. Okay. So hopefully you understood a lot of what we had to talk about today. So I think Shreyas, that answers your question. How many marks do you need in CR and English language and all that? There are 2-3 more things that are lined up for you. An All India Open Mock and the recordings of this paper discussion and all have already been discussed, and they should be already live on YouTube or either the recorded session or something. So take a quick photograph of this. There's just one or two more slides to cover. All right. Now, there is something called as an open SimClat, which is lined up. So again, take quick photographs of this. You've got tomorrow at 3 p.m. a live sort of SimClat. That will be all India level. So you can get a sort of comparative ranking with those who are our students, who are not our students, more or less like a representative of what could be your ranks in the actual CLAT. So there's a good indicator. Take a photograph of this as well. And use your login to go on the portal and watch. Take a photograph of this as well. Okay. Right. You'll get a rank by 9th. That's about it. And that's it. Join the YouTube page for more updates. If you can like, share, subscribe, kijiye, and bell icon dabaiye, and all that jazz. That's the sales pitch part of it. Hopefully you've gained something useful out of all this, and I hope I wasn't too fast or too slow. I've tried to keep it fairly interesting. We'll see you on the other side. That's it. My gyan is over. If there's anything, I'll wait for questions. If not, leave your feedback as to how the session went. And that's it. All the best. Okay, thanks. Bye.